Before Dee Broglie came in, physicists had partitioned waves and particles into two separate watertight compartments. But after Dee Broglie's hypothesis, this partition was about to break. Physicists at those times couldn't cope up with this new change. How can particles and waves, which seem to have two separate set of properties, converge at the level of small things like atoms or electrons and so on? It was counterintuitive for them. But then Dee Broglie came in, and the separation between particles and waves got severed. You might have heard of theories that light acts like a particle as well as a wave. How can light or anything act as a particle as well as a wave? That is due to what Dee Broglie found out. Now this is what Dee Broglie did. He mathematically proved it, that particles can exist wave-like properties and waves can exist particle-like properties, by using these two equations. The first equation that he used was Einstein's equation. He took Einstein's equation on the LHS, E equals to mc squared. It said energy is like energy equals to mass into c squared. And on the RHS, he took another equation for energy, which said energy equals to h into frequency. This is the Planck's equation. Now both these things have energy. So if both these things are an equation for energy, he said, let's combine both these things. So he said mc squared equals to h into frequency. He combined Einstein's equation and Planck's equation, and this is what he got: mc squared equals to h into frequency. Now mc squared can be written as mc into c equals to h into frequency. This is done so that mc can be written as momentum. Momentum is mass into velocity. In this case, it is velocity of light, so it's okay. It is momentum of a photon. So this is what he got. Momentum is written as p due to some reason. I've not figured out why, but in many textbooks you'll see that momentum is written as p. So momentum into velocity of light equals to h into frequency is what now we got. This is just a simple rearrangement of terms. He just kept seeing that if I keep on rearranging, what will I get? Now this is what he did. Frequency could also be written as c divided by lambda. So momentum into c equals to h into c by lambda. He said instead of frequency, I'm going to write c by lambda. It is going to be one and the same, because frequency equals to c divided by lambda. Basically what this equation means is that the greater the frequency, the smaller the wavelength. Imagine a wave, and these three fingers of mine are the peaks of the wave. The distance between them is the wavelength. The greater the wavelength, that is the more distant they are from each other, the smaller the frequency. And let's say now I bring these three fingers closer. This means the frequency is bigger. The frequency is higher, but look at the wavelength, it has reduced. So frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other, and there is a constant of light coming. So this is what he did. Instead of frequency, he substituted c divided by lambda. So now the resulting equation is momentum into c equals to Planck's constant into c divided by lambda. Needless to say, the next step, what he did was cancel the c on both the sides. So now the new equation what he got was momentum equals to h divided by lambda. Now he cross multiplied, and he took lambda on this side and momentum on this side. The new equation what he got was lambda, that is wavelength, equals to h divided by momentum. Now, as I have been saying always, that every equation has a story to say. So now what he did was meditated on the equation that he got. This was a very simplified equation, and this equation had a story, had a message for him. Lambda, that is wavelength, equals to h divided by momentum. So for some time he decided to meditate on this equation, wavelength equals to h divided by momentum. But how? He asked. Wavelength is something that is associated with waves. Red light, blue light, they have their own wavelength. And momentum, he said, is associated with particles. So this is the way he interpreted it. Everything, he said, that has a wavelength should have a corresponding momentum. So red light will have its own momentum, blue light will have its own momentum. Red light has its own wavelength, blue light has its own wavelength. Red light will have its own momentum, blue light will have its own momentum. Red light has a higher wavelength, so it will have a lower momentum. Blue light will have a lower wavelength, so it will have a higher momentum. So every wave, he said, has its own momentum, which means it has its own mass and its own velocity. Because momentum is nothing but mass into velocity. But the other side was also true, which meant momentum is associated with particles. That means every particle has got a corresponding wavelength. So an electron which has got a momentum, an electron which is in motion, will have its corresponding wavelength. A tennis ball will have a corresponding wavelength. A bus will have its corresponding wavelength. An elephant which is running will have its corresponding wavelength. Again, this was very counterintuitive. So these were the two postulates of de Broglie's hypothesis. One is that all waves have particle-like qualities like momentum, and all particles have wave-like qualities like wavelength. But this is a question that kept coming into his mind. Why doesn't a bus have a visible wavelength? He asked himself. We don't see a bus or an elephant running having wave-like properties. He looked at the equation much more closely. The equation was wavelength equals to h divided by momentum. In this case, it is the momentum of the bus. So what we are dealing with an equation that says that wavelength of the bus equals to h divided by momentum. Momentum of the bus. Now, let's look at this. H is a very small number. It's a very, very tiny number. It is about 6.65 into 10 raised to minus 34. So in the numerator, you have a very tiny number. And the momentum of a bus is relatively a very high number. So you have a very tiny number divided by a large number. Now, a very tiny number like 1, for example, or 0.001, for example, divided by a large number like 1000, it gives an even smaller number. It gives an even much more tiny number. So he said, so this gives an extremely tiny number, which is negligible. So he said, even a bus has got a wavelength, but it is so small that it is negligible. So now he asked, when does the wavelength become apparent, become visible, not apparent, when does the wavelength become visible to us? For that, he said, the wavelength has to be not a negligible number, a very high number. That cannot happen if the momentum is very high. Already h is a very small number, and this is a ratio, by the way. So if h is a small number, the momentum also has to be a small number. Then only will the wavelength be visible. For example, a small number like 0.001, if it is divided by an equally small number like 0.001 itself, you get 1. So he said that the numerator cannot be changed. It's a constant, it's a very small number. So we have to deal with those things which have such a small momentum that the LHS becomes a visible number, a number which is not negligible. Now momentum is mass into velocity. Velocity has to be there, for example, but the mass of something can be very small. For example, an electron. An electron has a very, very, very small mass, and so its momentum, even though its velocity may be very high, will be very small. So for an electron, lambda, that is wavelength, equals to h divided by momentum, will be a relatively big number, because a very small number is divided by an equally small number or a comparably small number. So you have a wavelength which is comparable. So for an electron, an electron or a photon or things which are very small can behave like waves. This was proved later by experiments done by G.P. Thomson, who achieved diffraction of electrons. The irony was, and a great twist of fate was, that G.P. Thomson was the son of J.J. Thomson. J.J. Thomson won the Nobel Prize for proving that the electron is a particle, and 30 years later, G.P. Thomson won the Nobel Prize for proving that the electron is a wave. So that was all from my side. This was De Broglie's hypothesis. What you're seeing is an excerpt from a book called As Quantum Leap. The link of it is below. Thank you.